So, do you think that a lot of the symptoms that have driven a lot of the airway craze, a lot of the maybe the sentiment, the pain that drives people to my channel and seeking remedy of mechanical airway, a lot of the sort of mystery symptoms commonly associated with UARS and sleep disordered breathing, do you think a lot of that is potentially exacerbated by environmental toxicity? Someone said to me recently, maybe it was my premolar extractions that turned me into this hypersensitive chronic pain patient, but maybe it was my childhood vaccines, because now there's a lot of talk about vaccines and how whatever 50 shots as a child can lead to potentially mystery symptoms and chronic inflammation throughout life. And you seem to be attuned to environmental toxins. How do you think that feeds into some of this chronic pain that airway patients are having, that where they then need to scapegoat it, or are they scapegoating it into the volume of their airway?
That's a good question. I think both. I think that environmental toxins do play a big role in chronic pain, chronic disease. That's known. That's a undeniable fact, science-based. But there's also a real anatomical issue that people are now more aware of, and it's a combination of both. But do I think toxins contribute to the chronic disease that we are seeing? And yes, sleep apnea is one of them. And I hope someday we have just straightforward answers where I could say, yes, this did contribute to the chronic disease. As of right now, we don't, and we can only do the best we can with the information we have. And I live by the 80-20 rule. Like 80% of my life is very clean, is the best I can do, but I can't control everything. Control all of it. And so I do the best I can. And I've seen it make a difference.
I guess I'm just trying to work out, like, some people have a imperfect bite and it turns them into an invalid, right? Like they have this chronic pain, chronic occipital neuralgia or chronic craniofacial pain because their bite is off by whatever. And then like boomers, like people that are in their 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, they'll have crazy bad bites and crazy small airways, and they're like out there crushing it on Wall Street and they're millionaires. And meanwhile, the 18-year-old Gen Z kid who has the imperfect bite is like bedridden. And it's, what's the difference between those two?
Yeah.
And the only difference I can think of, or one, I shouldn't say the only, there's a lot of differences. One of the differences I can think of is the amount of environmental toxins that younger people have been subjected to at an earlier age. And while claiming agnosticism on the particulars of this, like what's new for people born after 1985 or whatever, it's lots of vaccines, it's lots more processed foods, it's lots more EMF via cell towers and Wi-Fi and wearable electronics. And I just cell phones. I wonder how much those things are contributing to the hypersensitivity of younger patients. And I would consider myself among them, me being born in 1990 and getting all of my childhood vaccines per whatever was recommended. And I don't want to hammer too hard on vaccines, because I know how, and I'm not, if you would like to opine on the vaccine issue, feel free, but I know maybe you can't because of your situation, and I don't want to pressure you to, but I guess I'm more making a declarative statement and just offering you an opportunity to comment. But it is interesting how people age 35 and younger seem to be way more sensitive than people old.
Right. I think it is. It's not just one thing, but you're absolutely correct. It is an amalgamation of all the toxins. We're living in the cesspool of toxins. Sounds pretty morbid, but it's true. But everything you mentioned, I think, contributes to this state. Talk about vaccines. Yes, absolutely. People should do their own research and come to their own conclusions and read the studies. I'm not going to comment on that, but yes, absolutely. There are a lot of things that contribute to this chronic illness that I'm seeing. And yes, do I see it more in my Gen Z population? Absolutely. And are they on more medications, and are they all on things to help with what they're dealing with, such as anti-anxiety medications, antidepressants? Yes, I do see it more in the population than I did previously. All of this is, I think, it's not just one thing, but I think it's just added effect of all of it. So you said it very well.
Yeah.
And I actually have my colleagues, the people that I work with, I literally work with three of my best friends, and they each have a jaw anomaly. They each have, one of them has a lower jaw that's recessed, one of them's got a cross bite, one of them's got an edge bite. They all need jaw surgery, but they're very high functioning surgeons. And it's interesting, yes, when you do see a patient that comes in and says, my bite is killing me. And I say, I believe you, but it's not that straightforward. I can fix you a bite and all your problems go away. That's the reality, is I can fix your bite, but there are other things that also need to be addressed in order for you to feel like you should feel in your skin.
Heart just bleeds for Gen Z and younger millennials.
Yeah.
Or how difficult it is for us economically, health-wise, mental health-wise. And that's the generation that drives this space. I think a lot of the jaw surgery content has been really blown up by people that are age 35 or younger. And it's just, it's tough being a younger person. And I think that a lot of them see a potential answer in jaw surgery. And I fear that it is often deeper than that and potentially even harder to fix than that. Because a jaw surgery is just a thing you can go in and do and it's done. And if that solved all your problems, amazing. But I fear that it's possible that it runs into the internal medicine space a lot more than we care to admit, because a lot of that is that bell is rung and it can't be unrung on a lot of that stuff that we were exposed to as newborns and as children.